Bethel Park, and welcome to the Bethel Park Live Well Speaker Series. Tonight it's my great pleasure to have Dr. Tim Campbell here in the Blue, talking about the Blue Zone diet. It's live longer and healthier, lessons learned from the Blue Zone Centurions. So thank you, Dr. Campbell, for coming in tonight.
Very good. It's not so much the Blue Zone diet, Chuck, as it is more like a Blue Zone lifestyle. We're going to talk a little bit about that. So I'll start with the first slide here. You know, if we cured all cardiovascular disease, if we cured all cancers, all infections, all rheumatological diseases, all neurological illnesses, if we cured all kidney, liver, lung diseases, if we cured all blood disorders, if we cured diabetes, hypertension, cholesterol, and all the hypertension-related disorders, how old do you think we'd live to be? What's your best guess?
150?
Could we live forever? Maybe. 150? That's not a bad guess.
Maybe.
Well, what a good way to do it is to go back and learn historically what has happened. And for most of mankind, longevity only began to really increase in the last 30,000 years. The average lifespan has been about 30, less than 30 for most of mankind in our existence. In ancient Greece and ancient Rome, it went up to 20 to 25, in some cases 35 years of age. In the Europe in the 1500s, in the Middle Ages, through the 1800s, life expectancy plateaued on average about 35 years. The Jamestown plantation in Virginia, you know, when the colonists first came over, 26 years old. Here in the United States, 26 years old was the average life expectancy. In the United States in 1900, the average life expectancy was 40 years of age. From 1900 to 1940, our age expectancy increased 40 years. And why? Why do you think that happened? What happened between 1900 and 1940?
I'm going to say better aging.
a lot of people, and that's true. To some extent, that's right. A lot of people thought it was like the invention of antibiotics and things like that, but they didn't come around until like 1939 for sulfur, right after that in the 1940s.
I think refrigeration, too.
Well, actually, here's a clue, and I have it on the screen right now. It's a toilet. It was sanitation. By having clean water, by having clean sanitation, we were able to drop tremendously infant mortality, child mortality. So as a consequence, people were able to live much, much longer across the board. So that was probably what accounted for our greatest gain of about 20 years. And how are we doing today? Well, better, but not so great. Life expectancy today, the world average is 72.6 years. In industrial countries, about 75 years. In the United States, the average today is 79.8. If you look at men, they don't do as well as women. Women are about 81 years of age, and men about 76 years of age.
I got a quick question.
But sure.
Is there a reason why women live longer?
Yeah, they're genetically superior. Now, they have a lot of things. Estrogen does wonderful things for you. Really, truly does, especially your vasculature and your blood vessels. But a child who's born today is expected to live to 100. In Pittsburgh, we got kind of a unique experience, very unique experience. We flip-flop between Dade County, Florida, and ourselves to being the oldest county in the nation. Depends, a lot of the snowbirds go south in the summer, or in the winter, rather. But I had at one time in my practice over a dozen patients who were more than 100 years of age here in Pittsburgh, you know? So it's kind of interesting. So what do we die from? You know, what do we die from?
I'm going to say hypertension is the first one.
Well, in a lot of the hypertension-related disorders, you're spot on. Coronary artery disease, cancers, you know, all types across the board. COPD, now we're seeing a drop in that as smoking has decreased. But accidents are real big. Strokes, dementia, diabetes. A lot of the pulmonary infections like influenza. We've seen COVID so much in the last couple years. 2 years are really going on now. Pneumonia, chronic kidney disease, and actually suicide. Particularly in younger folks, more like teens, more in younger adults. You know, so that actually made the top 10 because of that.
I can believe that.
So I go back to the question, if we cured all illnesses, everything across the board, how old, Chuck, do you think we'd live to be?
I said 150.
150? Well, here, this is interesting. In my faith tradition, you know, I go to the scriptures a lot, but in Genesis 6:3, and the Lord said, my spirit shall not always strive with man, for he also is flesh. His number shall be 120 years. 120 years. And if you look at that, the epidemiologists, the scientists that go through the data, they come up with the same number, 120 years. So, why do we die? Why? What's the magic about 120? Why do we die at 120 years of age? Well, we have something called programmed cell death. It's called apoptosis. Your cells only have a certain life expectancy. They have, in our DNA, we have the gene, and then we have a lot of junk DNA on the outside. They call that telomeres. And every time your cells reproduce, it cleaves off a little bit more of that telomeres. And after a while, after so many repetitions and reproduction cycles of that cell, you get into the gene dies. It can no longer, it can no longer make the protein that that gene codes for. So if we could figure out how to make those telomeres longer, therein might lie the answer to immortality. So what can we do? Folks have a lot of crazy claims. You have to do nothing but go ahead and scan most of the media. There's a lot of anecdotal stories out there. Oh, this will do that. You know, green tea, cabbage soup, all this other stuff, you know, is the best thing for living a zillion years. There's a lot of softball data, and I call it feel-good data. But what if we just scrutinized the hard data, Chuck? What if we just looked at the medical evidence-based studies? And what better way to do this than to study the people who are already 100 years old, the centenarians? You know, why not study those who've lived the longest? They're the ones that are going to give us the biggest bang for our buck for finding out why. What makes them different? Was it just that, they all hit the genetic lottery? Are there behaviors that they do that really kind of did why they scored so well? You know, or is it, if it's all genetic, do we just throw in the towel and go home and get a quart of Ben and Jerry's ice cream and put it between our legs and eat it for dinner? You know, but I think the answer's ready. Let's go ahead and study it a little bit more. So there were two gerontologists. Giovanni Pess and Michael Poulain, they did this, and they actually published an article in the Journal of Experimental Gerontology, and they studied an area in Italy called Sardinia. It's one of the province of Nuoro, and they looked at that specifically because this one population had the biggest concentration of men who lived older than 100 years of age. And they hadn't seen anything else like that. So they called it, the way they zeroed in the village where these people live the oldest, and they made a blue circle around it. And then they make another big blue circle around it, and another big blue circle. So in doing so, they called this the blue zones, where these people were concentrated just by from when they're drawing these concentric circles on the map. And it was the blue zone became synonymous with folks who were able to, you know, the areas where people lived a lot longer. So, Dan Buettner, he was a journalist actually for National Geographic. He broadened the term a little bit. He wanted to look a little bit more and find out, was it just this area in Italy that they did that? So he applied it to other areas, Okinawa, Japan. He applied it to the Seventh-day Adventists in Loma Linda, California. And lo and behold, found the same thing. Blue zones, circling, concentric blue circles of people who consistently lived more to greater than 100. And then he and Poulain actually later identified two other places. Nicoya in Costa Rica, and Icaria in Greece. And that's how he came up with the term the blue zones. So blue zones are areas and regions where people seem to live much longer than general. And actually National Geographic published two articles on it. The cover story was really in November 2005, The Secrets of Living Longer. And they actually trademarked that term, blue zones, as you can expect. So I have on the map now, on the screen now, a map of the five blue zones: Loma Linda, California, primarily the Seventh-day Adventists; Nicoya, Costa Rica; Sardinia in Greece; Sardinia in Italy; Icaria in Greece; and Okinawa, Japan. It's interesting, if you look at those, they're all within 27 degrees north latitude of each other, you know, north of the equator. It's kind of curious. So what are the unifying features? I mean, there's different geography. They have different cultures, they have different foods, they have different activities, yet some consistency still remain. How do you connect the dots? What is the commonalities between all these people?
When you say they have different geography, but is the weather kind of the same?
Most of them are kind of in a Mediterranean climate. It's right, but not always. If they're not Mediterranean, it's subtropic climate too. So that had some insights with this as well. So Buettner wrote a book about this. He found nine lessons that emerged, and I'd like to elaborate on each of these points. And his book was called The Blue Zones, Lessons for Living Longer. Do you remember the Venn diagrams from high school, or from third grade, where they had the interlocking circles?
You're asking a lot there, Doc.
That's a lot. Well, the Venn diagrams are these intersecting circles, and you want to look at what are the areas that are common between these intersecting circles. Well, Buettner basically did the same thing with each of these blue zones. And what he found is there's certain characteristics that were very common within all the areas across the board. And those are the ones he zeroed in on. He said, these are characteristics that we find in every single one of these five zones. And that's what we put the nine lessons from it. And it was things like being involved with your family, no smoking, plant-heavy diet, constant moderate physical activity, social engagement, beans, you know, go figure. So did you notice there's a lot of different attributes in those circles?
Yeah.
But there were several overlapping areas. Some things were consistent with all the groups, and those are the ones that he wanted to really pay attention to. But only a few really had to do with diet and exercise. Of the nine, three had to do with diet and exercise. The other six did not. And what do we think of in America? And we tend to go right to diet and exercise. This is how you're going to get longer. And that wasn't exactly what Buettner found. So this is what he calls the power nine. You know, one is move naturally, just get more physical activity. Two is, look at this, a right outlook, you know, knowing your purpose in life, downshifting, getting rid of the stress in your life, working slower, working less, concentration on taking vacations and hobbies. And then eat wisely, yeah, more veggies, more fluids, you know, maybe a glass of red wine, don't stuff yourself. And then probably the bottom of his pyramid of the power nine was belong. Belong to a healthy social network. Connect with reconnect with religion or spirituality. Prioritize your family. So again, only three of these, a third of them were really diet and exercise. The others were all lifestyle. So not just diet and exercise. So I'd like to build a little bit on Buettner's work tonight. I'd like to look at the medical literature and see what it has to say to supplement with some of his observations. Because, you know, living long isn't the only real thrust for what we try to do. We want to live well. Isn't that the name of our program? Live Well Bethel Park?
It is.
You know, how do you live well? How do you get the most? How do you, carpe diem, how do you seize the day? You know, get as much out of living as you possibly can. So I'm going to start with the lessons, these nine lessons, and go through them kind of quickly tonight. First, he said moderate and regular exercise. Move naturally. Sir Isaac Newton says, a body in motion tends to stay in motion. Unless acted upon by an outside force. So moving naturally was very important to all the Blue Zone centurions. The world's oldest population, they live in environments that are constantly kind of nudging them, motivating them, encouraging them to keep active as much as they can. They might live on hillsides. They might live in farmland where they have to go ahead and do a lot of things to take care of their daily living. They might grow gardens or work on their house or work in their in the fields, go visit family members. They have to do a little bit of physical activity all the time. They didn't have a lot of the mechanical conveniences that we do. You know, they don't have they might have to go gather firewood in order to get ahead and light their stove. They might have to go ahead and, you know, go out in the garden and pick the vegetables rather than keep them in a refrigerator. So they were engaged. They didn't have a lot of our constant conveniences that we have today. But it was interesting. The centenarians, they did slow, methodical, but very consistent work. It was all the time. And it wasn't like brief splurts and rest. It was like a body in motion stays in motion. Natural movements. Activities such as, I said, food gathering, gardening, cooking, house, garden work. That seemed to make the big, big difference. And they really didn't have a retirement per se. You know, they may have retired from a previous job, but they still kept themselves being active. Exercise, oh my word. You know, we have so many studies to look at this now, but exercise truly is the best anti-aging medicine out there, hands down. It's the closest thing we have to a miracle drug. And just keeping in movement a little bit. And with talking about exercise, how much exercise is kind of important. The National Cancer Institute and Harvard University said any amount of exercise you do is better than nothing at all. Any exercise you do. So they did a study of 661,000 adults, middle-aged adults, and they separate them to categories from no activity to less than 150, 150 minutes, greater, you know, 450 or more. And they broke them down. Sometimes they even went to folks who were doing 25 hours of physical activity a week, 10 times the federal guidelines of 150 minutes a week. And here's what they found. The highest risk of death occurred, in the people who did not exercise at all. If you exercise less than 150 minutes a week, your risk for dying decreased by 20%. If you exercised about 150 minutes a week, that's the federal guidelines, your risk decreased about 31%. If you step that up, if you tripled that to 450 minutes a week, your chance of dying decreased by 39%. And if you exercise more than 450 minutes, didn't matter. You hit a plateau at that point. So Yeah. If you do any exercise, it's good. If you do at least 150, it's good. It's better. If you do up to 450, that's probably the best. And you're not going to get much bang for your buck if you can and keep pushing it more. So the types of exercise, there's cardio. Cardio is exercise that in workout that increases your heart rate, sustains the heart rate, improves cardiovascular fitness, and it improves your aerobic metabolism. You need oxygen to be able to do cardio work. That's what sometimes they call them aerobics. And then there's strength training. Strength training is more like a workout that has resistance to the muscles. It's used to induce muscular contraction. It builds strength, it builds muscle mass. It actually will prevent aging and it'll prevent the muscles from getting smaller and weaker. And with time, you know, because when you do aerobic strength training type of exercise, it's usually a shorter burst of time, more physically aggressive. You're not using oxygen as much, but that will help build tissue. So which is better? What do you think?
I think you need a combination of both.
Spot on. You know, both will protect you to some degree from the wear and tear of aging. Both exercises have anti-aging effects. Both have some overlap but augment different muscle, you know, different health benefits. As I said, strength training may build muscle mass. Cardio may help do more for protecting the heart. But it doesn't really matter. Regular physical activity, that's the key. Regular physical activity appears to be more beneficial than any occasional high-intensity, like HIIT type of workout. It's better to go ahead and do something regular and consistently. And that's what the Blue Zone Centurion saw. That's the lifestyle that they lived.
One question. Now, sure. To keep your mind healthy, is one form of exercise better than the other?
When I'm at the gym, I put headphones on. I put my brain in neutral while I'm on a cardio. So for me, that's mental health. That works out great. We'll talk a little bit about exercising the brain a little bit too, but that's important to ask. There's an article in Circulation from January 2018 that adults who exercised 4 to 5 times a week saw significant improvements in their cardiac performance over 2 years compared to a basic group who just did stretching or balancing. And it suggests that stiffening of the heart can be prevented, actually reversed with regular exercise on a regular and consistent basis. And this is what I want to tell you about the brain. Exercise in the brain. This is an article from Neurology Clinical Practice. This is May 2018. They showed that 40 minutes, just 40 minutes of exercise, 3 times a week, significant improvement in cognition, thinking across the board compared to people who did little or no exercise. They also showed that you have better processing speeds, better superior performance on tasks, better time management scores, and better ability to pay attention. So just that little bit of exercise can make a big, big difference, Chuck. So action item number one, from a cardiac perspective, 30 minutes of 75% of your maximum predicted heart rate. You calculate that 220 minus your age. That's your maximum predicted heart rate. You multiply that times 0.75. If you can exercise like that 3 times a week, and at least get your heart rate up from a cardio perspective, it's the best. But shoot for 150 minutes. That's what we learned from the data. That's what we're learning from the Centurions as well. 450 minutes a week is probably better. But again, any exercise is better than none at all. And the second lesson that the Blue Zone Centurions taught us was they ate primarily a plant-based diet. Let's talk about that. Hippocrates, father of modern medicine, he said, "Let thy food be thy medicine. Let thy food be thy medicine." The Centurions in the Blue Zones, they ate primarily beans, mostly fava beans, broad beans, black beans, soy, and lentils. That was the cornerstone of their diet. They got most of their protein, most of their nutrients from that. They ate some meat. They ate some fish. Mostly if they would have meat, they'd have a little bit of pork. But they ate it only average 4 to 5 times a month. And when they would have a serving size, is about 3 ounces. That's about the size of a deck of cards. That was it. Three times neat. They would get most of their protein from nuts, from complementarism with the foods that they would eat, and from the beans, of course. So what's a healthy diet? You know, you ask me ask a zillion questions, people, you'll get a zillion different answers. You know, healthy means different to different people, and it depends on what their underlying health issues may be. They might be allergic to nuts or gluten. They might be allergic to milk. They may not be able to tolerate fat very well. A lot of people have religious preferences or inconsistent constraints. They may not want to eat meat or not meat kosher meat, for instance. No alcohol, no caffeine. A lot of people have different goals depending on what their health constraints may be as well. But if you look at the human diet, if you look at the way we're designed, we are omnivores. We could eat a bewildering array of different food. If you go anywhere from the Arctic, you know, where they're eating, the Inuit Indians were ancestrally eating like whale blubber, and you go down to the tropics where they're eating mostly anything they can get their hands on, you know, a lot of folks, a lot of fruits and vegetables and root vegetables, you know, it's amazing the amount of stuff we could use as humans for nutrition. We're designed to eat fat. We're designed to eat carbs. We're designed to eat protein as macronutrients. And we function best with a wider selection of food because we can get more essential vitamins and minerals when we do so. If you look at our anatomy, from the mouth all the way down through the intestines, our dental structure, our gastric and liver bowel ducts, our salivary glands in our mouth, our pancreatic enzymes, the absorption that we can do in our intestines, we are designed really to get ahead and eat, like I said, a bewildering and digest and live and thrive off of a bewildering amount of foods. So diet varies over time as well, Chuck. You know, you're not going to feed a newborn baby the same thing that you would feed a teen who's growing like mad, or a woman who's pregnant or breastfeeding, or maybe a perimenopausal woman versus a frail elderly individual. And then if they're hypertensive, if they're diabetic, if they have cholesterol or liver problems, if they have osteoporosis or BEAST, they might have different ways that they have to have constraints within their diet. The bottom line is a diet that is suited best for longevity may not be the best diet for like mass building, strengthening. It might not be the best diet for pregnancy, and may not be the best diet for weight loss either. So again, it depends what your healthy diet is and what your constraints are. But the Blue Zone folks, what did they eat? Primarily a plant-based diet. Most of their calories came from plants, but they weren't vegan and they weren't vegetarian. They had considerable variety, mostly featured whole cereal grains, legumes, especially, as I said, the soy and the broad beans, a lot of nuts in their diet. And they ate a lot of what we really call whole foods, foods that are recognizable. If you'd put an apple in front of them, they'd know that's an apple. If you put a Twinkie in front of them and say, what's this? It doesn't look like food. So they kept away from a lot of the processed. It was minimally processed foods. They'd eat raw, cooked, ground, fermented vegetables and fruits. Fermented foods and breads as well. Typically, their meals would have no more than 5 ingredients in it. They would eat that simple. And most of their food, you could say they were really the buy local type of folks. All their food, by far, came within 10 miles of where they lived. Pretty amazing.
Now, you mentioned processed food. Is it better to buy organic? Is it better for us?
I don't really know the answer to that. I'm sure the people who sell you organic food will probably say it is. But you know, again, in this process, they were doing it. There are a lot of food. There are a lot of health constraints that have been ascribed to buying some of the commercially grade foods. But for the most part, it doesn't seem that there's been the studies that have been done so far don't show that there's a big statistically significant difference. If you're going to buy a green pepper that's not organically grown and or one that is organically grown. They haven't really shown substantial differences yet, but there's a growing market for that. I'm sure there's going to be a lot more research as time goes on. So beans, as I mentioned, beans are a cornerstone of the Blue Zone diet and the Blue Zone Centurions. They typically would eat half a cup to up to a cup of cooked beans a day. That's almost 4 times the amount that Americans eat. 4 times. And beans they truly are a superfood. 21% of protein, 77% of carbohydrates. And of those carbohydrates, a lot are fiber. They have more nutrients per gram than any other food that's out there. And bread, they would have bread, but interestingly, they eat two different types. They have whole grain bread, or they would have sourdough. Again, a fermented bread. If they're gonna do whole grains, they use like wheat, rye, barley. And again, these tend to have a little more fiber into it, a little bit more roughage, so to speak. And they had lower glycemic index. You wouldn't see the spike in the sugars that you would, like if we have a slice of the white baguette or white bread that we'd have, you know, here locally. And nuts, I found this great study. It was actually a meta-analysis. What they did is they pulled 5 huge studies together and did a prospective study, and they found that there's an inverse relationship between the amount of nuts you consume and vascular disease, meaning the more nuts you ate, the less heart disease, stroke, vascular disease that you had across the board. It was tremendous. They also noted that particularly walnuts and almonds seem to be best at lowering the LDL, the bad cholesterol, raising the HDL, the good cholesterol. Peanuts is on that list too. Peanuts aren't really nuts. They're legumes. They're not really a nut. A peanut is a legume. It's a bean. There'll be there'll be a quiz later.
No quizzes on medical stuff, Doc. Sorry.
All right. There's a nurse's health study. This is interesting. They said that if you substitute 1 ounce of nuts for the same amount of carbohydrate, you could reduce the risk for heart disease 30%. That was huge. And these are not small studies. These were stinking huge studies. What did they drink? Mostly water. The Seventh-day Adventists in Loma Linda, California, would drink up to 7 glasses a day. The coffee, they'd drink that mostly in the Sardinians, Icarians, the Greece, Italy, and then Nicoyans, those who were in Costa Rica. And tea, all the Blue Zone people drank tea. It didn't have to be regular tea. It could be herbal tea, but almost all of them did it, particularly the Okinawans. They would drink it. They would just nurse green tea all day long, all day long. Now, red wine, we hear a lot about red wine. That makes you live longer, right? Not all the Blue Zone folks used it. Seventh-day Adventists didn't use it at all. But if they did use it, maybe 1 glass, possibly 2 a day. It was typically more 1. They never had soft drinks, ever. They would drink more water. They didn't have diet. They didn't have regular sugared soda at all. And a word on sugar. The centurions ate sugar intentionally. If they had like a piece of fruit, if they had it in their vegetables, if they had it in their bread, they would have sugar in it. Most came from the vegetables, grains, the fruit. They averaged about 7 teaspoons a day, 28 grams. That's the same amount that most Americans eat for naturally occurring sugars. But they only ate 1/5, 20% of the amount of added sugar that we have. 20%. I mean, that was it. We eat so much more sugar than they did. So did they, the Blue Zone people, did they eat animal protein? Yeah, typically fish. They would eat pork, as I mentioned. But again, no more than 3 ounces, about the size of a deck of cards, and no more than just 1 or 2 times a week or 4 or 5 times a month. They would have some dairy products too, but it was limited. And if it's curious, if when they did use it, they would use sheep milk or they would use goat milk, and they would make yogurt with it or cheese, again, fermented products. They did have eggs also, but typically no more than 1 at a time, typically no more than 3 a week. So again, there were animal sources of protein in their diet. Now, a word on protein, and I pulled this article for JAMA in Journal of American Medical Association, the Internal Medicine Division of it. And this is a great study in 2016. They showed that animal protein was positively associated with mortality. That is, the more animal protein you ate, especially red meat, the higher your risk for heart attack and stroke. Plant proteins, like the ones that the centenarians, the Blue Zone folks ate, was mostly plant-based. It was inversely associated with heart disease. And if you substituted plant protein for animal protein, again, like nuts, whole grains, things like that, beans, it was associated with lower mortality across the board, a survival advantage to that. So it stresses the importance of the protein source. But did they still have animal proteins? Yeah.
Yeah. But it's the right protein.
It's the right protein. It's the right amount of protein.
No. Is white meat better than red meat?
Most of the studies I've seen have suggested that. Red meat seems to be the bad actor. The worst is really the processed red meats. The ones like ham, bacon, things like that. The ones that we, love, but just aren't really good for you at all. So if you look at the breakdown of the food that they ate, I spent most of the time this evening talking about the food guidelines. 95% of their diet was plant-based. 5% was only based on animal proteins or animal-based. 65% were carbohydrates. 20% were fats. 15% was protein. So in summary, 90-95% of their diet on a daily basis, they would do plant-based calories. They went more whole foods. They would do single ingredient, minimally processed foods, as we talked about. They would have their daily dose of beans, a half a cup to a cup a day. Most of them drank water, but sometimes they'd have tea, coffee, wine in moderation. They snacked on nuts, a lot of nuts, across the board. And as we saw, we looked at the data for that as well. On a weekly or monthly basis, fish, no more than 3 ounces 3 times a week. They limited their eggs just to 1, 3 times a week, if that. They slashed sugar, only 20 grams of added sugar a day. They reduced their dairy. If they would use it, it would be tend to be fermented, like in cheese or perhaps in yogurt. And they really retreated a lot from the meat. They'd use no more than about 3 ounces, typically pork, no more than 5 times a month. So action item number 2. We talked about exercise. We're talking about diet now. Plant-based diet was what they did for longevity. Again, if you have specific healthcare constraints, you might have to do things differently. Weight loss, you have to do things maybe a little bit differently. Whole grains, legumes, which are like the beans, including your peanuts there, Chuck. Okay.
I'm getting back to snacking on peanuts now.
Fruits and vegetables and then nuts in all their resplendent glory. Blue zone lesson number four. We're going to call this polyphenols. These are the wonders of the red grape. And this is another thing that came up. Love this quote from Thomas Love Peacock. The juice of the grape is the liquid quintessence of concentrated sunbeams. That sound great? All right. So the blue zone, Dan Buettner called this wine at five. All right. The blue zone folks, when they drink alcohol, they drink it very moderately and regularly. Again, except for the Seventh-day Adventists. They drink maybe one or two glasses a day, typically one. And they found that moderate drinkers seem to outlive the non-drinkers. And when they would have alcohol, if they would have some wine, they typically would do it with another person. They would share it with another person that have it with a meal that they're eating at the time. It's not like they could save up all 14 glasses of their wine a week and drink it on a Saturday night. Nope, sorry, that didn't work. It was, you know, one or perhaps two every day of the week spread out evenly.
I read something interesting. The French, they have, you know, the fattiest foods, mm-hmm. but they seem to have the lowest cholesterol rate in the world.
And like I said, we're going to talk a little bit about that as well. So I have a picture here, you know, a glass of red wine. I have a glass of white wine. You know, is it the alcohol that helps or is it something else?
Got to be something else.
Yeah, I wrote under there a hint. There's really is something else. Polyphenol is a chemical that's found in wine, and it's a variety of different chemicals. Most blue zone centenarians, they drank red wine. And red wine in particular is loaded with these chemicals called polyphenols. Resveratrol, you may have heard of that, quercetin, anthocyanins. These are different types of polyphenols. Cornell scientist Dr. Creasy, he first isolated resveratrol from red wines in 1991. And he theorized, he thought, maybe this is the thing that's causing people to have the health benefits. And son of a gun, he was right. But it wasn't just in the red wine. You can also get the same benefits from red grape juice. Not the white grape juice, the red grape juice. Because red grape juice also is loaded in the polyphenols. He also found out when they did this study, this is from Atherosclerosis, one of the vascular journals. Again, this is back in 2001. This has still been held up. Where they looked at red wine, de-alcoholized red wine, and they looked at grape juice. And they found that you can have lower doses and still significantly lower the risk for heart disease. And grape juice was more effective than red wine at inhibiting coronary artery disease, improving lipids, and lowering the bad cholesterol, raising the good cholesterol, and particularly its antioxidant properties. So their conclusion was grape juice or non-alcohol red wine are excellent alternatives to red wine and atherosclerosis.
So you're talking like name brand grape juices or...
I don't think they didn't really look at, okay, is Welsh is better than,
that's what you're saying, but when just you said grape juice. Red
like the
grapes.
Purple, the purple grapes. So, yeah. You know, again, there's a lot of different types of juices, grape juices. You got to look at it. A lot of them are mostly apple juice. You have to look for 100% grape juice to have benefit. And how much again? Probably 4 to 6 ounces. That's all you really need to know. So can you have a grape crush instead?
No.
No, doesn't work.
It's loaded with sugar.
Right. It's loaded with sugar, but it doesn't have any of the polyphenols in it, the resveratrol. And it's the resveratrol that it inhibits this, or it augments what's called the sirtuin pathway. And it's one of these pathways that are anti-aging. It does wonderful, wonderful good things for us across the board. So action item number three, drink 6 ounces. Like I said, 6 ounces is adequate. Red grape juice, or the purple grape juice, if you want to think of it like that. Red wine, or de-alcoholized red wine. You know, each day.
Okay.
All right.
I can do the red grape juice.
I can too. That's loaded with sugar. You can't go ahead and chug like a gallon, and that's not the intention. We're just a little bit every time.
4 to 6 ounces.
4 to 6 ounces. All right. Blue zone lesson number four: the 80% rule. This is eat till you're almost full, and they found this in every single one of the blue zones. Benjamin Franklin: the best of all medicines is resting and fasting. Ben Franklin said that. The Okinawans in Japan, they recite before their meals a 2,500-year-old Confucian mantra before they eat. And it's a reminder for them to don't eat so much. Don't eat until you're stuffed. Eat until you're about 80% full. And they eat their smallest meal in the evening or in the late afternoon. And then they don't do a lot of grazing in the evening like often we tend to in America.
That 80% rule is interesting because, you know, your parents, when you were a kid, they gave you, you had to finish your plate.
Oh, I know.
You were stuck.
But now we biggie size everything, Chuck.
Yeah, and I'm thinking, well, did that start us on, you know, a path of biggie size?
We
have to finish yet.
We have seen an explosion in obesity in America in the last 30 years in particular. Right. And a lot of that, how much that was processed foods, biggie sizing, more sugar in our diets.
Less exercise.
A lot of different things can do it. But the Okinawans, they use this term, harahachibu, and it's the name of this mantra. And actually, in English, it's roughly translated to be belly 80% full. And again, Okinawa has the largest population of folks who live over 100 years of age. In India, they have another philosophy, a yoga philosophy. It's called mithahara, and that means the habit of moderate food. And both of these focus on basically awareness of your food, being aware of what you're consuming, how much you're drinking, putting balance in your life with these things, and balance in your consumption, and how it affects the body and the mind. And if you think about it, 80% full, some aspects, and like if you shut down your eating after like dinner time and don't eat at all, you know, for a while, that's kind of calorie restriction, isn't it? And we hear a lot in the press today about calorie restriction. The centenarians, they ate sufficiently, but they didn't stuff themselves. They didn't make themselves so miserable. They had a balanced and adequate amount of calories. They had good vitamins, good levels of minerals and macronutrients. They minimized their grazing and their evening eating, you know. But excessiveness in anything in human nutrition is bad. I have a picture up here of a heart attack special, you know.
Oh yeah.
That I actually counted the patties on that and did the math with it. That is enough protein, animal protein, that would take care of most of the folks in the blue zones for about 3 months in one burger.
That's a heart attack on a plate, buddy. Yep.
But just like on the opposite, if you cut back your calories, there seems to be an advantage, a survival advantage to a little bit of calorie deprivation. So what's this this calorie restriction? Another Cornell scientist, Clive McKay, 1935, he found that if he didn't feed rats a whole lot, if he gave them 30% of what a rat would normally eat, they would live 30%. They would live 30% longer than those on a normal diet, just by cutting back their calories a lot. And scientists have been testing this on a lot of different, the impact on flatworms and fruit flies and spiders and fish, dogs, cats, primates, you know, animals, and other mammals. And they found that pretty much the same thing kind of holds true. If you cut back on the calories, there's a survival advantage to this calorie restriction. And how does that happen? I have up here next a pathways of all the different things that are involved with it. And it's really convoluted. There's at least 5, 6, 7 different pathways on how lifespan could be affected by the different enzymes in our body. But those are targets for a lot of it. You look at the bottom of that screen, you can see aspirin, you know, affects antioxidant gene expression, which will reduce free oxidative radicals. Antioxidants that we may take may actually also help out. Spermidine, that's a medication, or that's a chemical that's found in mushrooms and for instance, in aged cheddar cheese, you know, high levels of it across the board. Cauliflower, broccoli, that's also been shown to help clean out your cells. You know, there's a lot of different things that can be done. Metformin, the diabetes medicine, have you ever heard of that?
No.
Well, for type 2 diabetics, they'll often use this medication. We know that that has a target. It seems that when folks take it, there's a survival advantage to it. And so, especially for the diabetics, it helps them out tremendously. A lot of convoluted pathways here.
No. An aspirin a day, is that good for you?
It depends on the person. Now, again, that's something that would have to really be discussed with the patient. For instance, we know that an aspirin will probably reduce your risk for stroke and heart attack about 50%. But what happens if you have a history of head bleeds? What happens if you have a history of like gastric ulcers or kidney issues? You may not be able to do it. And we don't even, the data is kind of interesting. You can go from a quarter aspirin a day up to 4 regular aspirin a day. You know, as far as inhibiting the platelets, it seems to be all about the same. That's why we stop all aspirin a week before surgery, because we don't want you bleeding on the operating room table.
Oh, okay.
So calorie restriction, that can be done a lot of different ways. You could skip a meal. You might skip a day of eating. You might skip a couple days of eating. It really depends on, there's different philosophies about different ways to do it, but it does seem to clean out the cupboards. You know, it seems to reduce inflammation. It seems to preserve your healthy cells and help your mitochondria, your power plants within your cells. It reduces oxidative stress. This is a great study, this next one. This is the curious case of calorie restriction in primates. This is actually a study from University of Wisconsin and the National Institute on Aging, where they did calorie restriction on rhesus monkeys. And rhesus monkeys are probably kind of biochemically closer to us than any other animals. And what they found is calorie restriction mechanisms are likely translatable to human health. And what they did is they found that one monkey, well, he started on a 30% calorie restricted diet when he was 16 years of age. 16 for a rhesus monkey is like late middle age for a human. But they started him at 16 on this cardiac restricted diet, on this calorie restricted diet. He's now 43 years old. And in monkey terms, in human terms, that's about 130 years of age.
What's your normal life expectancy for these monkeys?
I think it tends to be probably like about 20 years, if I recall.
Wow.
But 130, you know, not 20, like about 30 years of age. But on this next screen, if you take a look, or that I'm going to go back to that screen. If you look at the monkeys, which one do you think is calorie restricted? I don't think we're back up there yet. But if you look at the picture of the monkeys, the one, it has like the real rich coat. It has a nice posture in its back. If you look at the skin on its face, it's not sagging. It has a good sharp eyes. That particular monkey was the one that was calorie restricted. The other monkey was not. And that's what they saw consistently over and over. It seems that when you calorie restrict, you kick up a lot of these genes that are engaged in preserving your cells, trying to keep them as much as we possibly can. And clean out the cupboard, so to speak. All right, let's move on here. So action item number 4, eat till you're 80% full. Don't stuff yourself. Don't sacrifice nutrition. You still need to eat healthy food, but don't stuff yourself. There seems to be some magic in that for the Blue Zone Centurions. All right, lesson 5, know your purpose. All right, know your purpose. Seek a meaningful life. I love this quote from Friedrich Nietzsche. He who has a why to live can bear almost any how. If you know why you're living, you know why you're doing something, you could bear any way how to do it. And I like this one from James Taylor. I love James Taylor. The secret of life is enjoying the passage of time. You know, actually he wrote a song called that. But the Okinawans, they have this, they live in particular, it was known with all the Blue Zone folks, but the Okinawans called it Aikinai. And basically, the Nicoyans called it plan de vida. Plan de vida is Spanish for the plan of life. It's basically kind of roughly translated as, why did I wake up this morning? Why am I doing this? Why am I going? What's my purpose in life? It seems that knowing your sense of purpose, if you know why you're here and what you're doing, it could translate up to 7 years of life expectancy, more life expectancy.
I can believe that. We used to have a camp in the campground, and you'd see the seniors that were still active in the, I hate to say it this way, but the ones that were just sitting there waiting to die. And I was like, get up and do something. Don't, you know.
Isn't that kind of like a will to live?
Yeah.
You know, it really truly is. And I can't tell you how many times I've seen in my career when I've seen patients, like a spouse will die and the surviving spouse like kind of gives it up. And yeah. They'll often die within a couple months of each other. Or if they've had a loss of a child or a significant loss in their life otherwise, you know, they lose their will to live. As a hospice medical director, I could tell you I see that over and over and over again. So how do you define a purposeful life? You know, it's defined differently by different people, but it indicates that a person has specific goals. They have a specific game, a purpose that they want to achieve. And how does that translate into longevity? Well, most authors feel that if you have a goal in life, if you've got some objectives, if you've got an aim, a purpose that you want to do, you're more likely to engage in behaviors that will promote good health. In Japan, as I said, they've got that particular word, ikai nai. I practice saying that over and over again. it's actually, it could be defined two different ways. One is something to live for, but it's also the joy and goal of living. The joy and goal of living. So clearly, it seems that a purposeful life is associated with survival. There was a study that was done. This is American Health and Retirement Study. This is done in 2010. They wanted to look at the long-term consequences of psychological well-being as well as the physical well-being of people. And they found that people who did not have a purpose, if they didn't have a goal in life, they were more than two times, 50% more likely to die than those who had a goal in life. It didn't matter if their gender, it didn't matter their age, you know, it didn't matter their educational status. If you had a goal, it was more important, a better indicator of longevity than those. In fact, this is really interesting. If you had a goal in life, you had it was more important for decreasing your risk of dying than drinking, alcohol, you know, drinking alcohol, smoking, and exercising regularly. If you had a purpose in life, you heard me right, Chuck. Again, this data comes from the study, American Health and Retirement Study, 2010. So it appears that any purpose in life for a person, any purpose at all, it's an important thing to have, you know, have something that makes them excited about, something they want to engage with. But that could be as important as smoking. I think in another study I read, it was up equal to 15 cigarettes a day if you had a goal in life, you know, reducing those risks. All right. One of my favorite Russian Russian authors, the mystery of human existence lies not in just staying alive, but in finding something to live for. He's saying the same thing. Look at this one. This is Bob Dylan.
All right.
He who is not busy being born is busy dying. And look at this one. Mahatma Gandhi. Live as if you were to die tomorrow. Learn as if you were to live forever.
I like that one.
I do too. I really feel like it puts a lot of things in perspective. So action item number 5, live purposefully, establish goals, seek out something that you could pour yourself into, that you're excited about, that invigorates you, makes you, it energizes you. And then next step beyond that, learn to lose yourself in service. One thing that was also seen with the centurions, Blue Zone centurions, is when they're in service, they seem to do much better as well. It excited them, it invigorated them, particularly the Seventh Day Adventists with the data I read with them. Number 6, downshift. Take time to smell the roses, Chuck. All right, yeah. Peter Lynch, listen to this. I like this.
I don't do that well.
We all don't do that well, and we should. Downshift. I don't know anybody who said on their deathbed, gee, I wish I'd spent more time at the office. As a hospice medical director, I can tell you I have never heard that. The Blue Zone people have daily routines. They have stress. They have stress just like we do. But they had routines that helped reduce that stress. They had better supports. Okinawans, they'd remember their ancestors. Adventists, they would tend to pray. Icarians, they'd take a nap in the middle of the day, typically. Sardinians, they'd do happy hour. You know, everybody had their own little routines for dealing with a little bit of stress. You know, see, if you think about it, you know, why are we so serious in the first place? Stress is terrible for us. It does nasty things for the body. You look like you want to say something about stress.
I get it. I know how it is. I'm the type A personality. You know, I don't, like, we got the turkey trot coming up. As soon as mm-hmm. that's done, I won't go, okay, yeah, this was great, and breathe for a while. We'll be on to the next thing.
What's the next thing? Right. Yeah. And we kind of live that. We're not so much living in the moment, but stress is a key feature in inflammation of the body. Inflammation is nasty for your tissues. It ages your tissues, all tissues in your body. And there's physiologic stressors. Like if you're sick, if you're ill, if you have a tumor, a bad infection, things like that, broken bone, that'll cause inflammation and stress. But there's psychological stressors too that sometimes we heap upon ourselves. Like, all right, we've got to get the turkey trot. Then after that, I've got, you know, as you just said, your litany of things, you know. But both psychological and physiological stressors can be harmful to the human body and affect our longevity. So, you know, some of the biggest things that I've seen with why people get serious, you know, get so serious and so stressed about are sometimes we take things too literally, Chuck, you know? Sometimes we overinterpret what other people read. We read something on Facebook or Instagram or Twitter, and then we all get ticked off about it, you know, because, you know, and we overinterpret their comments. And sometimes people don't have filters on that social media, you know.
A lot of times they don't.
They don't. But sometimes we feel responsible for everybody and everything at the same time. We just heap all this extra stuff on it. We focus on the negative instead of, you know, expect things to go wrong. You know, that doesn't accomplish anything. Go ahead.
My boss told me a couple months ago now, Lauren said to me, you have a telltale sign when you're really stressed. I'm like, I looked at him like he's crazy. He said, your sentences get shorter and he can't understand you.
Telegraphic speech, yeah.
I'm like, and I thought about it for a while. I'm like, man, he hit the nail on the head.
Yeah. Sometimes we really just need to put things in perspective. You know, are the issues that we get upset over, are they really worth getting upset over? You know, or is it really upset worth us getting other folks upset? You know, and sometimes we just offend people. We don't necessarily know we do it. You know, is the issue really important, I guess, is the question to really ask, you know?
You know, most of the time it's not.
No, usually it's not.
Like, something happened the other day, and I'm like, oh, you know what, it happened, but someone else has something worse going on, so let's just keep going.
And some things that were important to me 10 years ago don't faze me today. Some things that faze me today didn't bother me 10 years ago. But you look at the situation, too, is it really beyond repair? Is it really our problem in the first place? Sometimes we take other people's problems, and it's not really ours to worry or get concerned about. I want to talk about play for a little bit, because this is a great antidote for stress. There's a psychiatrist named Stuart Brown. He compared play to oxygen. He wrote, it's all around us, yet it goes mostly unnoticed and unappreciated until it's missing, and then you really notice it. You know, who knew there's a National Institute for Play? They wrote, when employees have the opportunity to play, they actually increase their productivity, engagement, and morale. Do you know that's part of the business model of Google? They have, like, places you could play?
One of our kids that came up through the rec department, he worked for the rec department. He had his choice coming out of college between Google and Microsoft.
Yeah.
He went with Google.
Because they could play more.
They could play more.
Still, you get the work done.
You could go in at 8 o'clock, take a break from 10 to 12, go back in, you know. It's how you want to do your days. Like, I don't want all that straight eight hours of stress.
Yeah, spot on. Here's another antidote for stress. Interpret others with generosity. You know, people are so quick to be offended. Sometimes we just need to give people the benefit of the doubt. Give them a little bit of a, like, cut them some slack, so to speak. You know, we are wired to be social creatures. We're wired to interact with each other. And are there exceptions? Yeah, there are folks that, you know, really kind of grate you wrong.
I think with all the technology, we're cutting back on the social interaction, and that's going to harm us in the long run.
It can. It certainly can. Technology has its wonderful advantages, too, but there are some downsides with it as well. But, you know, as far as, like, us offending other people, most folks pretty much what we want. You know, most folks don't want to cause ripples. We don't want contention. You know, so we need to perhaps enjoy a little bit more, lighten up ourselves a little bit more. You know, trust people more that folks are sometimes trying their best.
Nope.
Not up to our expectations. Another anecdote, Chuck, an antidote for stress. Be flexible. You know, I love this. Life is about the journey. It's not the destination. The secret of life is enjoying the passage of time, just like James Taylor said.
Because we all know what the destination is.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Do you want to get there sooner is what we're doing to ourselves.
Or live more robustly.
Right.
You know, the time we have, can we live it as fully as we possibly can? Most of the stuff is the journey itself. It's not the events. It's not the Thanksgiving, the holidays, the 4th of July, the Memorial Day, the wedding, the baptism, whatever. You know, most of it is like the brushing your teeth, the going to the bathroom, the going to work, going to school, you know, walking outside for a little bit, going ahead and cutting the grass. That's all the other stuff that's really part of it. It's the unplanned things. It's the stuff that that spontaneous stuff that occurs right out of the blue that really kind of delivers the greatest joy, the greatest fulfillment. And are there surprises? You know, yeah, sure, all the time when we get those, they may push us into doing things that we normally wouldn't do. Some of my most gratifying experiences in my life have been things that I've just decided to do on a lark, right off the bat, you know, or just kind of ended up in my lap and to be able to do.
I think if you get outside of we get in that comfort zone and we're comfortable there. If you get outside of it, it invigorates you, it makes you excited.
Spot on, exactly. So that's next slide. Break from habits occasionally. The detours, the disruptions that you just mentioned whatsoever, they, you know, we get us a little bit more comfortable when we get these little surprises in our life. It strengthens us. That which doesn't kill me makes me stronger, you know. So we embrace the benefits of the unplanned, departures from the things that are routine. And it gives us sometimes a step back and let us look at the situation and see things a little differently, different insights, different perspectives. You know, you see the sunlight. You see the sunset or the sunrise. You see the changes of the leaves and the trees. You hear a kid's laughter. You may not have. You know, those are the things that really make the biggest difference.
I think you appreciate that more as you grow older. I mean, in the 20s, you're like, don't worry about it. And now I'm like, wow, look at that. There's reds and oranges. You're
Bingo.
Looking at the leaves, and it's exciting now.
It
in
is.
20s, you're
or
like,
even the smells of the leaves. You know, I just love that. So coping with seriousness, get rid of the negative self-talk. Sometimes we have in our head a monologue, I'm not good enough, I can't do this. Get rid of that. It doesn't accomplish anything. Get more mindfulness. Being in the situation, just as you'd mentioned too, look at those leaves, smell the leaves, listen to that kid laughing, you know. Move. Listen to music. Move to music. You know, that really invigorates us in so many ways and can comfort us. And surround yourself with folks who are fun and supportive, you know, good friends and family. So action item number 6. Downshift. Be less serious. Prioritize play, recreation, hobbies. Pour yourself into your hobbies. Take vacations and breaks. And if you're going to, keep that time sacred. Keep that time special and protected that you, only you could really go ahead and compromise
there's,
that.
Well, you know, we went through the rebranding with the rec department. And we looked at other slogans and I can't remember where it was. And their slogan is, put a little play in your day.
I love it.
I like the tone. I'm like, nah, we're not using it, but I liked it.
It says a lot. We should still be doing that anyway, Chuck.
Work hard, play harder.
Next Blue Zone lesson. Create a healthy social network. That is, choose the right tribe. Now, what do you mean by tribe, Tim? I love this quote. This is from Audrey Hepburn. My daughter Nicole looks just like her, I think. But true friends are families which you can select. True friends are families which you can select. Isn't that? That's kind of nice. So here's two other anonymous quotes. Surround yourself with positive people who are going to push you towards greatness. People can either inspire you or drain you. Pick wisely. That says something. The centurions were either chose their tribe or they were born into social circles that supported good, healthy habits. Okinawans, they had what are called moieis, which are groups of five people. And they had five real close friends, and they were committed to your friendship for life. That's what they saw with these BZ people. And the Framingham Heart Study showed that your social network influences your good behaviors. If you tend to have problems with depression, you surround yourself with depressed people, you tend to be more depressed. Same with obesity, same with alcohol, same with drug use. You know, so your social network can affect your longevity. If you tend to be around people who are more physically active, you know, who challenge yourselves a little bit more. There seems to be a longevity advantage. That all came out of the Framingham Heart Study. That study's been going on 60 plus years, more than 60 plus years, you know, so far. But it's so important to connect with others. You know, connecting with others decompresses the harmful levels of stress that we have. We just talked about how bad stress is, particularly for inflammation. But when you have caring behaviors, they actually trigger a release of hormones that reduce stress in our body. There's a bunch of hormones that are off. Neurotransmitters like dopamine, your reward transmitters rise. Oxytocin, a chemical that they used to call the love hormone. You know, we release more of that when we're involved in caring relationships. Lower levels of epinephrine and adrenaline, the stress hormones that are in our body. And positive behaviors, you know, that could be like offers to help. You know, what can I do to help, Chuck? You know, if you need some advice, I can offer that too. Active listening, just talk. You know, if you need to get things off your chest, and expressions of affection, you know, things like that could really translate into not only life-enhancing benefits for the people who are getting the help, but also the giver as well. The receiver and the giver both benefit. Quality of relationships matter also. This study was done, there's three studies here. Midlife women who had highly satisfied marriages or relationships, committed relationships, they had a much lower risk of coronary heart disease and cardiovascular disease compared to those who had less satisfying relationships, almost up to 50%. One study found that, actually, they did immunity studies on couples. When they were fighting, you know, marital couples, tremendous decrease in their immune response when they were fighting, because the stress hormones, cortisone, epinephrine, you know, they can impair your ability to fight infection, for instance. In a large Swedish study, this is again folks who are 75 years or older, and they concluded that if you had a bunch of those who had the greatest number of friends, those who had the greatest number of family relatives that they had good relationships with, they had a much lower incidence of dementia across the board. Go figure. So relationships do matter. I love this next picture. This is actually a picture of two women. They're both centurions. They're both greater than 100 years of age. They have been best friends for 79 years. I just love that picture. And here's a couple other articles, two articles I want to talk about. Journal of Epidemiology of Community Health, 2005 article, study on aging. It was actually done in Australia. They found that people with the most friends outlived those with the fewest friends by 22%. They also, this is another article, PLOS Medicine, a 2010 study. This is a meta-analysis. They took 150 articles, pushed them together on aging, and looked at more than 300,000 individuals. And they found that people with the strongest social ties, 50% chance of survival over those who did not. This health risk was so important. I mentioned earlier the 15 cigarettes. Having friends, and having, you know, those with the fewest friends was similar to smoking 15 cigarettes a day, and more dangerous than being obese and not exercising. That is how important that they found that with this data from the Blue Zone Centurions that relationships are. It's we're wired that. If you want to do something, yeah, it's important to go ahead and exercise and keep away from smoking and alcohol as much as you possibly can and do the and eat properly. But it's as more important to head and be involved with your family, involved with your friends, know your tribe.
And being involved, exchange and talking, that not being on your phones.
Well, again, that's a recent phenomenon. We don't have a lot of good data on that yet because of the social media explosion. But the action item for here was be active with your tribe. Focus on the meaningful relationships. Choose activities to do that you could do together, if at all possible. Anything that brings you joy, share it with another person. A memory shared is always so much sweeter, isn't it? And then delegate or discard tasks that eat into your time, or if you have to, do them with a friend. We're getting kind of close to the end now. But the Blue Zone number 8, we only got two more, and these next ones are a little shorter. But reconnect or connect with the religion. Believe in something. Doesn't even say what to believe in. Believe in something. C.S. Lewis, you never know how much you really believe in anything until its truth or falsehood becomes a matter of life or death for you. C.S. Lewis, fascinating man, wrote some great books. All but five, 263 of the Blue Zone Centurions, all but five belong to some faith-based community. There were different communities scattered throughout the world. Denomination didn't seem to matter at all. But attending a faith-based service four times a month added on a little, look at this, Chuck, an average of 4 to 14 years of life expectancy. 4 to 14 years.
Wow.
That's huge. And a lot of folks kind of blur that, don't have a real good understanding of like religion and spirituality. Religion is more like a series of, like a specific set of beliefs, organized beliefs, practices. They're usually shared by a community or a group of people. Spirituality tends to be more personal, more individual in practice, and more dedicated towards a sense of peace and purpose. And I've seen this defined a number of different ways, but these are the most common definitions I see between the two of spirituality and religion. But they share a lot between them. There's a lot of commonalities between the two. Both provide an ethical and moral framework. Both will provide perspective, reflection, introspection, to be able to look at yourself and see yourself. Both instill, again, we talked about that sense of purpose. They may have a lot of bearing on that, an understanding of where did I come from? Why am I here? Where am I going? You know, both of those have some impact on that. And again, that helps to do with the target that we talked about, the goals.
Yeah. Speaking of stuff like that, it seems to me the older generations relied on their faith more than we do now, and they seem to be calmer, just looking at stuff.
Yeah, again, that is so personal and so individual from person to person, it's really hard to do it. How do you quantitate that? How do you measure that?
Oh, yeah.
You know? But here with the Blue Zone folks, they're able to quantitate it in life years, 4 to 14 years. You know, spirituality and religion both can be transcendent. They can bring peace and a lot of comfort to people, but they can also give you a sense of awe and wonder. They can inspire music, art, you know, tremendous, tremendous things. Here's an article I pulled from, this is, again, another meta-analysis, Religion, Spirituality, and Health, the Research and Clinical Implications. This was another meta-analysis. They took 3,300 articles from 1870 up to 2010 when they published this in 2012. They looked at any time there was mentioned spirituality and religion, what were the incidents of depression? What's the incidence of anxiety? What are the incidents of drug abuse? Things like that. And here's what they found. Those who are actively engaged more with religion and spirituality, 79% increased concordance with living well-being, a sense of well-being, a sense of happiness. 73% with increased hopefulness. 81% with increased optimism, 93% with a sense of purpose. We've talked about that. 61% with a sense of control over your destiny. 56% reported lower. If you, again, were you involved with religion or spirituality, 56% reported lower levels of depression and anxiety, 75% lower levels of suicide, 86% lower levels of substance abuse. And they didn't really have enough numbers to get and say about bipolar affective disorder, schizophrenia, some of the other affective disorders. But attending to the spiritual seems to provide a lot of comfort, a lot of relief for many people, tremendous mental health benefits across the board, encourages healthy lifestyle, healthy choices, and it focuses on a person's agency, that is, their choice, their stewardship, their ownership in their own health as well. So action item number 18, believe in something. I'm not saying what to believe in, but just believe in something. Denomination doesn't matter. Doesn't matter if it's religion or spirituality. But being inactive in any spirituality or religious endeavor or activity on a regular and consistent basis seems to impart significant survival advantage as based on the people and the information we've seen from the Blue Zone Centurions in all the Blue Zones across the board. Number 9, final one, prioritize family. Family first and foremost was their credo. This is a theologian, David O. McKay. No other success can compensate for failure in the home. No other success can compensate for failure in the home. The Blue Zone Centurions, they put their families first. They kept their aging relatives close by, maybe in the same house with them, multi-generation houses. Those who committed to a life partner had a survival advantage of 3 years of life, added life expectancy. 3 years, just by being if you committed to a life partner. They were invested in their children more. They spent their time with their children, their resources, their love, with these children. And in a lot of aspects, too, that came back to them because it finding out that with time in the Blue Zones, that it was those folks who were more likely that they cared for were more likely to care for them when the time came. So as a hospice and a medical director, I see a lot. I deal with these disaster missions, as you know, too. I go on a lot of deployments, and I've seen a lot of folks die from COVID over the last year and a half. I've never, ever, ever, the biggest regret I ever hear from somebody who's dying or close to their demise, when I talk to them and sit down and just have a real good chance to let them and vent and talk and express their feelings, nobody has ever said, anything but, I wish I spent more time with my family. I wish I spent more time with my family. And, a lot of this has to do with acceptance. Imagine how much closer we would be, how much every family would be, if we just accept people for what they are. Don't try to change them. Be more accepting of the loving ones that those are around us. I love this next quote. It's better to bite your tongue than eat your words. No. But we need to learn restraint. We shouldn't criticize family for what they're not or what they never will be. That just brings up a lot of walls. It alienates people. It kills relationships. We need to be more graded with our response. My mom and dad always said, make sure your brain is engaged before you put your mouth in gear.
Now that you're saying that, that is true. And I'm thinking about people on social media. They don't. It's hit the keyboard warrior, put it out there.
And you can say things that, with our nonverbal skills, you don't have the capability of nonverbal communication. Okay. Like we are here being able to look at each other. Sometimes when you type something, it could be misconstrued completely from what you write. But we need to be gradiated. We need to be controlled in our responses, more tempered, more civil in our responses. Yeah. Avoid the "you should do this." Instead, use the "I feel you may want to do this." Or if you have to, don't say anything at all. But also, just as bad are the long, cold, icy stares. Silences. Sometimes that could throw more cold water on a relationship than anything else you could do. Right. We need to be grateful for the time we get. Our generation, we just talked about this. We have more constraints on us for time than any other generation ever before. You're available 24/7. Somebody could hit the phone. They can call you anytime they want to. They can reach you just about any way they can. And sometimes very inappropriate times. But it's not about the quantity of time. It never was about the quantity of time. It really is all about the quality of time. And sometimes if you just express to a family member, I wish I could be more with you. I have the desire that I wish I had more time for us to be together. Communicate that. That expresses love. you know, we don't want to make people feel guilty. Oh, you never come over anymore. Here I lie sitting by the phone, you know, waiting. You know, you don't want people to feel inadequate. You know, who wants to be around folks like that? That triggers a lot of negative feelings, but appreciate people for what they are able to give you. You know, and I always like this too. When you think about it, a lot of the things we do, this is unrecoverable time. We might not get a do-over. Sometimes we have one shot. Our children will be only children for so long before they grow up and they're doing their things on their own. Our elderly, the clock might be ticking with them. We may not have them, or a sick relative, or the infirmed, or the frail. We may not have them along for very long. So thank them for the time that they do spend with you. Spend time with them. That's precious, unrecoverable time. Avoid the guilt trips, as we talked about.
Time's the only thing you can't get back.
That's right. Positive attributes and positive attitudes foster positive relationships. We need to go ahead and make that infectious, not the other way around. So again, the quote from David O. McKay, no other success can compensate for failure in the home. In family, it should always be our primary focus, A family doesn't have to be your blood relative. It could be your tribe. It could be your friends, your family, you know, your neighbors, yeah. Your buddies, you know, the folks you hang around with. Anybody could be your tribe. Anybody could be your family, depending on what we make of them.
In our house growing up, it was God, country, family. Mm-hmm. And it always wasn't in that order. The order rotated with my dad, depending on what, you know, what we needed at the time.
I appreciate that. So I have to use this last line. It's Spock. Can you do that? Hey, that's pretty good, Chuck. That's good. Live long and prosper. It's not just about living long. It is prospering. It's not just living. It's living well. That's why we named this Bethel Park Live Well series. You know, life is not just about longevity. It's about the quality, not the quantity of life that we have. I'd like to have more quality or quantity as long as I have quality to that life.
Yeah.
You know? But it's about living each day fully, robustly. You know, you heard the expression, carpe diem, seize the day. That's really what it is. We should be able to seize the day. You know, we're so fortunate. We have so many things in our advantage that sometimes we need to look at the glass being more half filled than half empty and be grateful for the things we have. And gratitude, you know, the magnitude of your gratitude affects the altitude of your attitude. It really does.
It does, because, mm-hmm. You know, getting back to what I do for a living, you know, I want to enjoy, we're going to plan the turkey trot. You know, there's going to be issues, and we'll correct them, but I want to enjoy it more this year than I did in 19. You know, last year, especially for people in recreation, was such a downer because you've seen all your programs, all that, and it was just like, now what, you know?
Now, some degrees of normalcy coming back.
It is, nice. And this year I feel much better just because the normalcy's coming back, and you're seeing, you know, the seniors from Lifespan at the center, you're seeing the kids, you're seeing the people exercising. It's like, okay, yeah.
Good. Yeah, again, how much of that has to do with our attitude as well. You know, I made some suggested readings. These are, again, I did not write these books. I'm just reporting on the books. I just wanted to take some of the medical evidence that's out there and kind of bolster it, make it a little bit stronger. You know, the Blue Zone book, they have a Blue Zone diet, the Blue Zone challenge. It's like a 4-week challenge, and I had to start putting things into play. But I think Dr. Dan Buettner did a wonderful job with these books.
I think that's the one I have a Kindle, so
yeah,
I think that's going to be my next read.
Next read, you betcha.
Yeah, I've been reading all crime.
And that's good, too. That's good, too.
It was the Kill for Thrill Spree in Pennsylvania, that wasn't too good. So yeah, I think the Blue Zone.
Yeah, all right.
Is next.
Garbage in, garbage out, Chuck. Fill your cup with a lot of good stuff.
Yeah.
Well, I hope this is helpful.
It has been. I like doing it this way. I think we used to do it live in person, and you get 10 or 15 people,
mm-hmm.
and we stumbled upon this with the COVID thing you did with Lawrence, and
yeah.
It was like, this is a better way to do it.
We have a broader reach in that way.
This once a month thing for 6-7 months a year has gave me more satisfaction than a lot of things I've done.
Good. That's,
you know,
important.
Because it's like, if we reach 200 or 300 people or 500, you know, if they get one thing out of it, if we help one person,
one at a time, that's what it's all
one
about.
One at a time, it is.
Well, thanks for the opportunity. I'm so grateful.
Thank you. I enjoyed it. It's a lot of information, and, you know, Bethel Park, please come back next month when we, December 22nd, we will talk about living well in your home. We'll have Sean Gorman, Fire Chief Dave Gruber and someone from Tri-Community South EMS talk about how we can live better in our houses. So that should be a good talk, too. Thanks, Doc.
Thank you.
And good night, Bethel Park. All right.